everyone. With us here today are three members of the Boston Higashi School. Mr. John Kwalling received his bachelor's degree in English from Marist College in 1992 and then graduated from Lesley University in 1996 with his M.Ed. He is a certified special education teacher who has worked as a vocational teacher, classroom teacher, art teacher, and various supervising positions at Boston Higashi School for 17 years. Currently, he is the division director for the elementary and middle school divisions. Ms. Heather Katz is the division director at the Boston Higashi School. She has been working with children who have autism for 17 years. She has taught at private schools and public schools in three different countries, as well as presented nationally and internationally. And last but not least, Mr. Brett Armstrong. He received his associate's degree in physical education from State University of New York and his bachelor's degree in physical education with a concentration in adaptive PE under the watchful eyes of Dr. Huber from Bridgewater State. He is a former CPDC clinician and now is a physical education teacher at the Higashi School since 2008. Please give them a warm welcome.
Thank you. I'm John.
We also have with us Kazu. Been a PE teacher at Boston Higashi School for 10 years, and behind him is Tomoko. How many years, Tomoko?
13 years at Boston Higashi. Tomoko is the master teacher of the phys ed department. Kazu is a phys ed teacher along with Brett. And a lot about Boston Higashi School is it comes from Japan. So Japanese culture and Japanese educational methodologies are a big part of what we do at Boston Higashi School. So, at the core of it with us, we're going to talk a little bit about what we do with Higashi, and then we're going to explain what all these fun-looking things are for, and the most fun part of the morning is you get to try them all. Please don't get hurt. Did you sign the waiver and all that? All right, at Boston Higashi School, we're up in Randolph, not too far from here, and we have actually a lot of Bridgewater State University, or when it was college, students that currently teach have done very, very well, so if you're in this program, you're probably very prepared, if possible, someday, to send us an application. Just my little plug. Cut.
Okay.
So what we do at Boston Higashi School is called daily life therapy. The last time I was down here, I spoke too long about it, so I'm going to try to be very brief.
It's a unique educational approach for students with autism spectrum disorder.
All the students in our school have a primary diagnosis of autism. Does anybody here know someone with autism? Perfect.
We know now autism is defined as a collection of symptoms that tend to occur together. Each individual with autism is unique.
And even to this day, 2012, the causes of autism are still unknown.
One of the statistics about how often it occurs, one in every 166 individuals, when Heather and I started back a long time ago, I think it was one in 10,000.
That's just been the so-called epidemic of autism. But most people are tending to believe it's the diagnostic criteria that have made it look like there's more people with autism, but there is some evidence that there is actually an increase.
It's four times more prevalent in boys than girls. We're not quite sure why that is so. And it
goes across all racial, ethnic, socioeconomic backgrounds all over the world. There's the same basic percentage of people with autism. Our educational approach is 24 hours of education. The title of our talk is Be an Educator, Not a Medicator. One of the trends to work with people with autism, because they may have a lot of maladaptive behaviors, is to give them medication. It slows everything down, makes it easier to manage. However, there is no autism pill. You know, somebody who may have a different psychological issue, such as bipolar disorder, that is a chemical imbalance in the brain. You can take a medication to regulate those impulses and chemistry of the brain, and that's very helpful and very effective. With autism, that isn't true. They give them a type of medicine kind of off-label, so the side effect makes them more lethargic or, you know, more in control, but it doesn't actually treat autism, and we tend to find it takes away their personality and who they are as a person. Daily life therapy is using the character of the person to overcome difficulties. So we mean our children off medication, What do you do instead? Well, we do a lot of physical education.
That's the core of what we do. So there we go. We don't use psychotropic medication. We're not using a behavioral approach. There isn't a token economy. There isn't timeout rooms or punishments if you're wrong. And there aren't candies and rewards if you're right. It's all about your intrinsic feeling of conquering and challenging difficulties. We don't have one-on-one. We teach in a group all the time, so you feel more comfortable with your peers and you have role models. Like, you guys are more comfortable out there because you're in a group. When you try these things, you'll be more comfortable in a group. If I took one of you out right now and said, hey, we're going to ride the unicycle, you're probably going to lose your confidence real quick. But if you're in a group trying hard together, you're going to increase your confidence. So that's a lot of what we do at the Higashi School. And a lot of the behavioral interventions we use, there's a lot of things. Physical stamina building. This is a crucial part of our education. And hopefully this will be really in tune with what you guys do here. If you build up your body and you get a lot of exercise, you tend to sleep better, eat better, you have better mental health. It releases endorphins in your body that inhibit anxiety. We use all those same principles with people with autism, and it truly helps regulate their life. A lot of children with autism have their rhythm is off. They don't sleep well. They're stuck on certain fixated foods they won't eat, so sometimes the nutrition is off. Because their sensory input is very different than ours, they may be, you know, certain sounds bother them, so they may do things like this, and eventually they have an awkward gait, or the way they present their bodies is difficult. They may feel strange about stepping on the floor. So you see, have a lot of toe walkers, and their bodies tend to be a little bit awkward. So building up those bodies so that they can use them more efficiently is a big part of our approach as well. We want them to be emotionally stable. Obviously, we teach a lot of the regular subjects so that they can have, you know, reading and math and all those things. But today we're going to emphasize exercise. Here's a picture of the Boston Higashi School road race. All the students at our school, we have about 130 some odd right now, the first thing they do when they come to school is they change into the Higashi uniform. They go over the schedule for the day, and then we jog. The high school students may jog up to 2 miles. And I work with the little ones, and some of them can even jog up to a mile. Can you imagine being 8 years old, come to school, and jog a mile? But so these kids are tough. They get strong. No one comes to Higashi School and likes to jog. They either like to bolt away, or you have to help them a lot. But eventually they feel how wonderful they feel when they jog, how wonderful they feel when we wean them off those meds, and they get something more natural to take over. And they sense winning. They sense triumph. They sense conquering something difficult. That brings out who their character. That brings out their will to try hard. And we treat them just like a typical child. They'll win a trophy if they're the winner. And everybody will clap, and everybody's encouraged. There's a lot of studies that back up what we do about vigorous exercise helping to lower also self-stimulatory behavior. A lot of times when you're anxious, you might flap your hands or bite your nails. Children or people on the spectrum may do a lot of gross motor activity, jumping, or a lot of noise or vocals. A lot of exercise tends to bring that down, as well as working together, coordinating your activities with others. A lot of this equipment we use in the younger divisions, but when they get to junior high or high school, we teach team sports. One of the challenges for people on the spectrum is to work together with others. So creating a team sport is a great opportunity for them to integrate into the community. And it goes back to some of the classical, you know, educational theories, like even back to the Greeks, the body and spirit are one. And if your body is strong, your spirit can also become strong. And if you're trying to overcome all the challenges that autism presents, you got to have a strong character, a strong spirit. And that's what we're trying to build up. The PE equipment is one of the ways we do it. The four elements of physical education when they're really, really young, even when they're old, play. We pick them up, we play with them, we put them on our shoulders and spin them around and tickle them and wrestle them and really get to know them in a physical way. And then we start building up their physical stamina. Like little kids, when they're really young, jogging sometimes isn't their favorite thing. We get them on the bouncy balls that we didn't bring. If you ever sat on those big balls and go like that, it burns out in here like crazy and it builds up your lower body. And we kind of teach from the feet up, kind of like you grow a tree. Build up the legs, make your body strong, and work your way up. We do things in a group, like I mentioned, the benefits of that. And we try to do age-appropriate equipment. You
know, most people aren't, we don't want our children to grow up and join the circus. That's not why we're teaching the unicycle. We're trying to build up that sense of character and accomplishment. I mean, how many people in here can ride a unicycle?
Those two can over there.
And Brett, those three can. So if you see someone riding a unicycle, that's totally amazing, right? And you don't have to, we call it real praise versus, it's hard for me to say this without being facetious. That's one of my challenges. Sometimes, you always want to praise children for trying hard, and you always want to encourage them to keep them motivated. But sometimes tying your shoes or buttoning your shirt isn't as glorious as riding a unicycle. So you have to, as an educator, you have to kind of dig down deep and you're almost acting, good job with that, good job with your shoes, good job with that. And that's great, it's very important. But if you see someone ride a unicycle, like watching the Olympics, you kind of have a holy beep moment. That person can do something I can't do. And when you get a child with autism, showing typical developing society that they can do something we can't do, you flip the entire table on the game. And that's what we're all about.
Some of the outcomes of the BHS curriculum is probably a lot of the outcomes you guys are working on here. Improving balance and strength, coordination, concentration, fostering the spirit and body to persevere. We want a lot of confidence in yours and others' accomplishments. Diffusion of energy is the huge thing. I think in autism, one of the studies says that 90% of people with ASD have a sleep disorder. So getting a lot of exercise, getting yourself ready to sleep is really important. And like I mentioned, creating a dynamic of gaining respect through demonstrating a learned skill that others can relate to and admire. Mastery of recreational equipment. So much of our children,
usually don't go home with your family and do the times tables as a family activity. Or you usually go to the park and play frisbee or go on the swings. Or go for a bike ride with your family. Children with autism, that's something that's sometimes overlooked. We teach them other than the things we teach here. We teach rollerblades, bicycles, and the kids can go home with their families and go rollerblading, go biking. And then they can do that with peers and when they get older and part of the community. So that's a big part of helping them rejoin through physical education. And you have to, when you do group sports, you have to trust each other. So you build up a lot of cooperation, a lot of those social skills, healthy rhythm of life. And we always do things in a group, so you're always being cheered for because you've done something difficult, and you always have a chance to cheer for somebody else.
There's our school.
It's a huge campus. We have 55 acres. We're up in Randolph if you ever want to come by. We have a lot of open houses, and that's where we go to work and sweat every day. Is that it?
Yeah, now you're going to say Brett's going to come on and explain.
Now I'm going to say, Brett's going to, does anyone have any questions before I move on about Higashi and autism? Okay.
What year did it start? Maybe I missed it. What year?
The school actually started in Japan in 1964. A kindergarten teacher, a regular ed kindergarten teacher, took an autistic child into her classroom. Her name in those days was probably Mrs. Kitahara, but now it's Dr. Kitahara. And she basically built up this methodology by applying Japanese education to this child. Japanese education is much more balanced than U.S. education. Art, music, and PE are core curricular. Here they're extracurricular. So you have standards that you have to meet. You have to jog at a certain amount of time. You have to swim a certain amount of laps. You have to do all these equipments. So she just gave an autistic child the opportunity to try all those things. And then Japanese society is very, very structured, even for typical people. The train comes at 8:01, it comes at 8:01. That all happened to be amazingly beneficial for the way people with autism learned. So she saw that this happened, tweaked it, and made it into what we call day life therapy. It came to the U.S. in 1987. Any other questions? We are residential. We're also 365. We have three tiers. You can come for 217 days. That's a day student. You can come for 304. That's a residential. And you can come for 365. But most of the children go home on their vacations and weekends. And we do a lot of parent and sibling training to integrate them back into their families. I'm going to hand it over to a
Bridgewater State University alumni, Mr. Brett Armstrong.
What do you got?
Hey guys, I'm Brett Armstrong. I'm gonna introduce some of the equipment we have here. First, I just wanna tell a little story about how I got to Higashi. In 2006, I was sitting right where you guys were, watching these guys do their little spiel and trying all the equipment. And it was right around the time when I had to get ready to do my internship for Dr. Huber's adaptive PE program. And he had me set up at this place, the Hebrew Rehabilitation Center, which I'm sure is a terrific place, nothing against it. But I went there for my interview and to see what I would have to do, and there's a lot of pushing wheelchairs, elderly people, and they played a game called Volley Balloon, which was you hit the balloon at them, and sometimes they would hit it back. So, short notice, I went back to Dr. Huber, and he wasn't very happy about it. I just can't go there. I need to do more. So this turned out to be an awesome place for me, and I encourage all of you to check it out. Come to an open house, set up a tour if you're interested in employment. Check it out. But I'll get right to the equipment and how you will be my lovely assistant. We'll start right from the little kids. There's youngest kids we have, the elementary division. They start with the balance disc and the pogo stick. We have a couple of adaptations we make, like draw footprints on it. Sometimes we put wooden blocks on it to keep their feet in position, just to teach them something, give a very clear direction about where to put the feet. Hop on, Kaz. We have at Higashi. Attention. Okay, we have at Higashi. We have basic posture. So we have attention, at ease. If someone gets a little too excited, tell them to sit down and make pose. Okay, it just gives clear directions about what to do with your hands or what to do with your body, rather than what, like, stop flapping your hands. Them positive, clear direction. Right, stand up, positive attention. So, when it comes to the balance equipment, we have basic postures with these two. So, step one, I'll get positive attention. Balance this ready, but one foot on, and ready, get on. Alright, so in the balance disc, it's kind of a waddle. You have to move your hips. So, step one, guys, with both hands, hand over hand. One, back and forth. And then you're gonna try to get him to twist his body forward. As you do it, the more you practice, you kind of want to decrease your prompts. You want to move away, let him become more and more independent. Good job. The next piece of equipment we use is the pogo stick. Same type of thing. Basic posture with attention. Pogo stick ready, one foot on, ready to get on. And again, same thing with prompts. You can hand over hand, hold on, push down, pull if someone's really unbalanced, you can hold it from the back. We just have to keep increasing the prompts and increase independence. Very good. Alright, then the students move up a division, they go to the middle school division. And, equipment in there. The stilts and the unicycle. Stilts, again, we teach, an American way is to put your foot on the side like this, but we teach Japanese way, so you can put your toes on the stilts. It's the same thing, tension, balance. Stilts ready, get on. And how we teach the stilts is first we'll put them against the wall, and the student will practice just getting up and staying on stilts. Getting down. So get up, get down, get up, get down. Repetitious practice. And once they're comfortable with that, we'll move maybe a few steps away from the wall. And the goal will be to take two or three steps towards the wall and lean against the wall. So we just keep increasing independence and further and further and set our expectations high. Probably the most difficult we have. The most precision does this as well. And if you guys take a look over there, we have all these chairs set up. So the initial guidance is then we'll get on the unicycle and hold the chairs. And just practice going from chair to chair, keeping their balance and holding onto the chairs. Then we'll maybe make a gap between the chairs and have to go by themselves the distance of one chair will just keep increasing, and eventually we'll go 40 feet across stage with a bunch of people watching. So, guys, if you want to meet today, you guys can try this too. If you want. Guys, we can try this. just about everybody. All our kids can.
If I can just jump in and add to what Brett said, that what he was just talking about is an example of how we teach everything in Higashi. The expectation is very high, like riding a unicycle, but you start very small, step by step, so that you experience success at each step. Your confidence stays, motivation stays, and you keep working up. Also, it also reflects a very Asian way of teaching, where everything kind of like wax on, wax off. You have a step, like you have to stand at attention and hold your stilts. It's not just a get up, but really be ready. Readiness at each moment for each thing we teach, whether it's reading, writing, math, or the same.
We take all of this equipment and all of the students put on a huge presentation on stage. We have professional lighting crew, professional sound. They do it in front of 1,000 people, so there's spotlights and spinning lights. And you have children with autism on stage, going across the stage, on the unicycle, on the balance disc, in a choreographed performance. And of course, I forget the video, so I can't show you any of that. But that's a huge part of our program, like John was talking about, instilling that confidence. But if you can imagine little kids trying to not only be successful on that, but to do it in front of 1,000 people and on a stage. So they put in a tremendous amount of effort every day to accomplish learning to do that. Do you have any questions about anything before we have to wrap everything up? Yeah?
What was the symbol for the school that you saw on like,
the... Yeah, the symbol for the school is... The symbol for the school originally was like a phoenix. So the mystery holder, and then that was a person letting a bird go free. So our symbol was trying to really free our kids, giving them wings to become independent, because our ultimate goal is for our kids to be as independent as possible, as social as possible, in giving back to the community. So not just, you know, taking from the community, but participating. So this is the guy's head, this little tiny blue dot, that's the man's head. These are kind of the arms. This is the bird's tail. You can kind of see it, and those are the wings. So he's helping the bird to become free. So, nice question. We've not been asked that question.
We had a staff member who was with us for like 12 years, and he heard that, and he goes, oh, really? I just thought it was this letter C, and I was almost trying to figure out.
Any other questions?
Down here, over here.
Yeah. So the question is, how long does it usually take for a student to learn the unicycle by themselves? PE teachers.
Well, it depends on the student. Some longer than others. We work up to our annual celebration. Some it'll take the entire time, and then the last day they'll finally get it and ride it across stage. Others are more coordinated, more pick it up quicker, but it takes lots of practice. It's just repetition practice over and over.
It's about 4 months from when we start teaching it until we end teaching it.
At least 2 months.
What age would a person in the unicycle? What age would you start a person?
11 or 12, probably.
About 11 or 12, they start to do.
What about pogo?
Same age. Or sometimes younger.
No, that's younger. Pogo and balance disc are the youngest kids.
So like 6-year-old adults
are the next division, and then the division I teach. We get gymnastics.
Yep. Our school is licensed for kids age 3 up to age 22. So we have about we can have about 140 students. Right now we have 130 approximately. And of the 130, about 95 live with us on campus, and the rest go home. It's an international school, so we do have a lot of kids from the UK. We have kids from New York, from California, Connecticut. The staff is international as well. Obviously, we have our Japanese staff. There's only two Higashi schools in the world. It's a very unique program. The original school is in Japan, the mother school, and then Boston Higashi School is the only other school that teaches using the philosophy of daily life therapy. So we have Canadian staff. I brought the Canadian contingency with me. We have a lot of Kenyan staff. We've been recruiting a lot from overseas. We have a couple of British staff, a couple of American staff.
You're talking American
staff. So not only are the students international, but the staff as well.
Besides Higashi, we have another school for children with autism out of Framingham that's also large. They're different in terms of culture, let's put it that way. But I have students every now and then, like Brett, who didn't want to go into gerontology but found an interest in autism, okay? And I've had students in my concentration say, I'm going to work with the blind, I'm going to work with children who are autistic and so forth. So some students in my concentration literally point to a population they want to be involved with. And from that, we can look at environments that house or school those particular populations. Higashi does a wonderful, wonderful job. If for no other reason, if you're looking at individuals with disabilities that have never been to their campus, have never seen the work that they do up there, you got just a small taste of it here this morning. It'd be really of interest to go up there and spend the morning or a full day with them and walk around and see what's happening. I don't know if you allow that to occur.
We do. We're very open.
You know, but I would think so. It's really.
Heather can take your hours.
Josh and I give the tours. And of course, we're so foolish. We do this all the time. Did you bring any cards? Business cards? No, neither did I. So we never remember to bring the business cards. But Boston Higashi School, look us up online. We have a website. We're on Facebook as well. There's a main number. If you just call that and say that you want a tour of the school, come on up, we'll give you a tour. We also have what we call open house, so it's open to the public. Anybody can come to it. We just had one on Friday, for example, and we give you a 2.5-hour tour of the school, set you free. You're allowed to go into any of the classrooms, see what's going on, but you're more than welcome to do that. We love Ridgewater.
You have snippets on YouTube?
I'm sorry?
You have little video snippets on YouTube?
Yes. John and I have absolutely zero skill in technology. We come out and we do the speaking, and then we ask Brett, do we have Facebook? Yes, you have Facebook. Oh, okay. We have a Facebook account, apparently. Apparently we're on YouTube as well.
Generation gap.
Yes, the generation gap. Yes.
There's lots of pictures on Facebook of some of our school events. We just had a sports day, lots of pictures from that, annual celebration pictures, just daily life pictures. There are videos from annual celebration on YouTube. Some opening ceremonies. Yeah.
One thing
stuff, so check it out.
One of the things that has to be emphasized in terms of the culture, the real culture at Higashi is how faculty are high energy. I've always noticed that about this crew. And about the entire day, the entire week, you have PE involved with the student throughout the day. It's not that they go to a PE class for an hour and then end, but they have academics and they break for activity, academics break for activity, academics break for activity. And I think that's an ideal way to harness the energy of children with autism. It maintains their attention, both for the activity side of things and going back to the academics. You can talk more about that if you wish to.
Yeah, I mean, we find that when we're teaching an academic lesson and the children, our goal as a teacher is make it fun, exciting, and real so that they can be engaged. But even with all of that careful planning and material making and all that, they still might not be ready. So you can, as a classroom teacher, you might be teaching for 10 minutes, everyone's getting squirmy, people are showing a lot of behaviors. Okay, everybody stand up, let's do a little jogging. In every classroom, they'll put out some orange cones or they'll put some chairs in the classroom, we'll jog around the classroom for 5 minutes, sit back down, try again. So it's integrated throughout the entire day. Every time we're trying to get a child to focus, language isn't always the best modality. It's usually a very kinesthetic way. We can tell you guys are focused because Dr. Huber's here putting the pressure on us. You're all looking with your eyes, but a child with autism, often eye contact is hard to get, and reaching into their mind with language is hard to get. Finding out they're focused is usually attention, at ease, touch your head, touch your shoulder, doing some crazy imitation games that they have to focus on, and then look at the board, then pick up your pencil, and then do what you have to do.
But this activity is you say, let's educate, not medicate.
Yep.
This activity is hand in glove part of enabling you not to have to medicate. I think that's the fundamental thing you're trying to leave with the students.
Exactly. And it's interesting because medication, if you take medication and you go off medication, there's a withdrawal. I mean, your body is dependent upon that. And I would say one of the side effects of daily life therapy is your body is dependent on exercise. So when these children leave Boston Higashi School, adult services usually don't have Bretts and Kazus and Tomokos to be jogging 3 miles with them. So what are they going to do for the rest of their life? They're not going to have pogo sticks and all these type of things. We teach them how to access health clubs. They take yoga. They do exercise equipment like treadmills and exercise bikes and enter the community that way. Some of the really, really gifted kids with athletics do road races. We've had many children do 5K road races in the community, and they've never come last.
So I used to work in a work program where a couple of the students over there, they used to go to Boston Factory, they would always see the sun, like almost every day. They still like, I think it's
the sun comes up, the sun.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so interesting.
That is so interesting. Wow. We have a study, actually, we have a survey out right now because we're trying to do a lot of research with adults who have graduated Higashi and the outcomes of how they're doing. And there's a lot of the group homes or adult or day habs or whatever will say there's something different about the Higashi kids. Maybe it's because they're singing or maybe they're bright and cheery or something of that sort. So we're trying to actually quantify that a little bit. But that's a great comment, thank you.
There's a question in there.
Yep.
Are there any students that are nonverbal?
Most.
About 80% of our students are nonverbal.
How do they do versus verbal? Is it
as far as the PE stuff or just
or
in
just
general?
Like communication
wise? We use total communication, so up until all this technology showed up, we used a lot of communication cards pointing to pictures, pointing to symbols. We will still honor sign if they use sign. But now with the iPad, that has revolutionized communication.
Yeah.
And the program Proloquo, where you can press those same symbols, but now you have a voice. So the kids who used to be the nonverbal kids were, they wouldn't talk out in class. Now those kids are talking out in class. I want water. I know the answer. It's awesome. It's really great. So that technology has actually really helped most of the kids to have a voice now. So. But we never give up on speech. A lot of our kids, music is really big in Higashi. We come back and do a music thing. And a lot of the kids learn their first language through singing, through music.
Every classroom has a karaoke machine. One of the requirements being a classroom teacher or a PE teacher even, you come in the classroom every day and we sing songs in the morning. So everyone, you pick up the microphone and regardless of whether you're singing tune or not, and most of us do not, you sing very, boisterously in the microphone and then pass it along to all the students and have them do it. So, we often see Brent Tomoko and Kazu with microphones.
Actually, Tomoko's a great singer.
Yeah.
She's in the chorus group.
That's right.
So,
yes.
Kaz is a great guitar.
That's right. So our teachers are multi-talented, definitely.
We're at that point where we have to say goodbye.
Yes.
I'm going to turn it back, but thanks a million for coming down and spending another.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks.
We have a great time here.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Good luck with all the great work you guys do.